Ladies and gentlemen, the Speaker of the United States House of Representatives, the Honorable Paul Ryan.
Thank you very much. I want to welcome all of you to the Capitol Visitor Center. I especially want to thank the members of the Congressional Black Caucus for helping us organize this event. Today, we are celebrating the 150th anniversary of the 13th Amendment's ratification. I should point out that we are here in Emancipation Hall. This was named in honor of the enslaved workers who helped build the Capitol. I could think of no more fitting place to celebrate this great moment in American history. So I just want to say on behalf of the U.S. Congress, thank you all for taking the time to be here with us. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the presentation of the colors by the United States Armed Forces Color Guard, the performance of our national anthem, and the retiring of the colors. Please remain standing as the Chaplain of the United States House of Representatives, the Reverend Patrick Conroy, gives the invocation.
Let us pray. Lord God of mercy, we gather to remember an iconic moment in our history when millions of souls in America were declared to be freed men and women, and slavery was forever formally banned from the United States of America by the adoption of the 13th Amendment to the Constitution. It was an advance in our evolving sense of those freedoms we have come to believe define us as a self-governing people. Unfortunately, the badges and incidents of slavery perdured for some decades in black codes and myriad other devices intended to maintain a separate but equal mythical world. The pains of racism, like a national genetic defect, plague us still, though so many wish it were not so. Lord, have mercy on us. Bless those who have been elected to secure laws protecting and expanding our cherished freedoms with the wisdom and vision to root out all traces of involuntary servitude in our nation, most notably in human trafficking in our own time, so that we can declare with pride we are the land of the free. Bless us as we gather here today. Help us to give honor to our ancestors whose heroic political exploits set us on an ever-expanding course toward freedom for all people. And dear God, bless America. Amen.
Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, United States Representative from the 1st District of North Carolina and the Chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, the Honorable G.K. Butterfield.
On behalf of the 46 members of the Congressional Black Caucus, I would like to first thank Speaker Paul Ryan and congressional leaders for authorizing and sponsoring this historic program today. We also thank President Obama for his participation in issuing a 13th Amendment proclamation last week. The ratification of the 13th Amendment is arguably the most important day in African American history, and indeed American history. Thank you, Speaker Paul Ryan. Thank you, President Barack Obama. The year was 1830. 2 million slaves resided in the United States. In addition, there were 300,000 free people of color who had obtained their freedom. Many of them were engaged in business and were prospering. Some even had the audacity to attempt to teach slaves to read and write. Some became preachers of the Word of God. Free blacks were doing great things, but they ran into resistance from slaveholding states. In 1830 and 31, many southern states, particularly my home state of North Carolina, made it unlawful to teach a slave to read or write. They also made it unlawful for any free person of color or slave to preach in public or officiate as a preacher or teacher in any prayer meeting or other worship where slaves of different families were gathered. The punishment for committing either crime was a fine for whites. For free persons of color or slave offenders, the punishment was a sentence of 20 to 39 lashes on the back. The teaching of slaves and the preaching by free blacks was greatly impeded, but it did not end. Slavery continued. Ladies and gentlemen, the Congressional Black Caucus and congressional leaders are now prepared to present you with a historic narrative about the challenging path along the road to abolition. You will find a ratification timeline printed on the back of your program. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Honorable Richard Durbin, the Honorable Tim Scott, the Honorable Steny Hoyer, the Honorable Steve Solis, the Honorable Eleanor Holmes Norton, and the Honorable Mia Love.
The year was 1860. A Republican from Illinois, Abraham Lincoln, was the Republican nominee for President of the United States. While candidate Lincoln did not call for the elimination of slavery, he firmly stated that he was opposed to slavery's expansion into the territories. Southern states were skeptical of Lincoln's motives. They threatened to secede from the Union if he was elected. Lean forward to January 31st, 1865. The 13th Amendment passes the United States House of Representatives. However, the Constitution requires that 3/4 of the states officially endorse a proposed amendment before it becomes officially part of the Constitution. In Springfield, Illinois, it was a matter of local pride. Immediately after the amendment passed on the 31st day of January, Senator Lyman Trumbull telegraphed Governor Richard Oglesby of Illinois, urging him to ensure that President Lincoln's home state would be the first to ratify the historic proposal. The next day at noon, Governor Oglesby forwarded the news to the state legislature, along with the directive that the 13th Amendment is just, it is humane, and it should be approved now. By 4:30 on the afternoon of February 1st, both state chambers in Illinois had ratified the 13th Amendment by large majorities.
President Lincoln was elected on November 6, 1860. 7 southern states seceded from the Union prior to Lincoln's inauguration. 4 additional states seceded immediately following the inauguration. A brutal civil war ensued that tore the nation apart, North against South. Northern whites strongly supported the complete abolition of slavery. Southern whites were opposed to abolition because they contended that slaves were their property and not subject to federal law.
The Civil War rages on from 1861 until the spring of 1865, when Robert E. Lee surrenders the last major Confederate army to Ulysses S. Grant at the Battle of Appomattox Courthouse in Appomattox, Virginia. The Civil War was fought in thousands of different places, from southern Pennsylvania to Texas, from New Mexico to the Florida coast, and right here in our backyard, just a few miles away in Maryland. Thousands fought and died on both sides of the battle line. Nearly 620,000 soldiers, including nearly 40,000 free and runaway slaves, died from combat, accident, starvation, and disease during the war, which to this day marks the largest total number of deaths in all American conflicts. Maryland, a slave state, was a border state. But its proximity to the capital city and opposing viewpoints attempting to sway public opinion, Maryland played a major role in the American Civil War. And the contradiction of slavery in a nation founded on freedom. On February 3, 1864, Maryland becomes the 4th state to ratify the 13th Amendment.
The state of Louisiana was the 16th state to ratify the 13th Amendment on February 17, 1865. However, prior to that time, the Civil War was already shaping the kind of nation our country would become, created by a declaration that affirmed all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. Among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it. The Civil War started because of deeply ingrained and uncompromising differences between the free and slaveholding states, pitting brother against brother, and father against father, and son against son, over the power of the national government to prohibit slavery. At the war's end and the loss of hundreds of thousands of lives, the long and difficult process of rebuilding our country would begin.
While the District of Columbia was not a state, and still is not the state it strives to be, and therefore was not involved in the ratification process, the district has its own story of abolition. During the Civil War, President Lincoln encouraged Southern states to abolish slavery and offered monetary reimbursement to slaveholders if they complied. None agreed. During the Civil War, Massachusetts Senator Charles Sumner, a vocal abolitionist, asked President Lincoln, and I am quoting, "Do you know who is, at this moment, the largest slaveholder in the United States?" Sumner informed Lincoln that he was the largest slaveholder because the president, quote, holds all the slaves of the District of Columbia. In December 1861, Massachusetts Senator Henry Wilson introduced a bill to end slavery in the District of Columbia. Despite considerable opposition from slaveholding congressmen, the bill passed. President Lincoln signed the legislation on April 16, 1862, almost a year before the Emancipation Proclamation, thus ending slavery in the District of Columbia.
Utah would see, 30 years following the ratification of the 13th Amendment and the abolishment of slavery, before it would become a state. The practice of slavery was not considered widespread among the pioneers, but some did bring slaves with them during the expansion to the West. In July 1862, Congress abolished slavery in the territories. A few months later, September 22, 1862, President Lincoln issued a preliminary Emancipation Proclamation warning the rebellious states that if they did not return to the Union in 100 days, by January 1, 1863, he would, as Commander-in-Chief, emancipate the slaves in the rebelling states. The states did not return to the Union and refused to free their slaves. Lincoln pronounced, "My paramount objective in the struggle to save the Union is not either to save or destroy slavery. If I could save the Union without freeing any slaves, I would do it. If I could save it by freeing all of the slaves, I would do it. If I could save it by freeing some and leaving others alone, I would also do that. What I do about slavery and the colored race, I do because it would help save the Union. And what I forbear, I do not believe it would help save the Union." This was President Lincoln's way of softening the blow of military emancipation. He was preparing the public for what he knew was sure to come.
Ladies and gentlemen, Professor and Chair of the Department of Music at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, Dr. Louise Toppin.
Freedom. my grave and go home to my Lord and be free. No more weeping, no more weeping, no weeping over me, and before I'd be a slave, I'd be buried in my grave and go home to my Lord and be free.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Honorable John Cornyn, the Honorable Alma Adams, the Honorable Cory Booker, the Honorable Will Hurd, the Honorable James Clyburn, and the Honorable Sanford Bishop.
On January the 1st, 1863, President Abraham Lincoln issued the final Emancipation Proclamation. All persons held as slaves within any state or designated part of a state, the people whereof shall then be in rebellion against the United States, shall be then, thenceforward, and forever free. And the executive government of the United States, including the military and naval authority thereof, will recognize and maintain the freedom of such persons, and will do no act or acts to repress such persons or any of them in any efforts they may make for their actual freedom. The proclamation by its terms did not apply to border states which were not in rebellion against the United States. It only applied to the states in rebellion. Texas abolished slavery on June 19, 1865, when a Union general by the name of Gordon Granger arrived at Galveston Island with troops. They would enforce the two-year-old Emancipation Proclamation by his General Order Number 3, which reads, "The people of Texas are informed that, in accordance with a proclamation from the Executive of the United States, all slaves are free. This involves an absolute equality of personal rights and rights of property between former masters and slaves, and the connection heretofore existing between them becomes that between employer and hired labor. The freedmen are advised to remain quietly at their present homes and work for wages. They are informed that they will not be allowed to collect at military posts and that they will not be supported in idleness either there or elsewhere."
Despite his defense of the Emancipation Proclamation as a military measure, President Lincoln had lingering doubt about its constitutionality. And while he felt the courts would sustain it as a war measure, he questioned its force once peace was restored. We already know that the slaveholding states argued that Lincoln did not have the authority over their state because of secession. The states even contended that slaves could not be freed under international law. Lincoln retorted that the rebellious Southern states continued to exist under the authority of the United States Constitution, thereby granting authority to him as commander-in-chief to act. The process of enforcement began throughout the land. After House passage of the 13th Amendment, the North Carolina General Assembly voted for ratification on December 4, 1865, and the state was readmitted to the Union in 1868.
Slavery was abolished in New Jersey in 1846. However, the law came with obtuse definitions that can be considered a gradual abolition of slavery at best. The law redefined slaves as apprentices to their masters for life. In New Jersey, slavery would officially end, along with the rest of the states, in December of 1865. Meanwhile, the presidential election of 1864 was very eventful. President Lincoln was reelected, even though the Emancipation Proclamation was having its effect in the Confederacy. Lincoln feared that some blacks might remain in bondage after the war's end. He was looking for greater guarantees. A constitutional amendment was needed to legally abolish slavery in all of America. The 13th Amendment was introduced in the Senate prior to the 1864 election. On April 8, 1864, the Senate passed it by a vote of 36-8. On June 15, 1864, the House of Representatives defeated the amendment by a vote of 93 in favor, 65 opposed, and 23 not voting. The amendment came up 13 votes short of the two-thirds required to pass a constitutional amendment. Despite President Lincoln's encouragement and efforts, the amendment failed to pass the House.
With no Southern states represented, a few members of Congress pushed moral and religious arguments in favor of slavery. Democrats who opposed the amendment made arguments based on federalism and states' rights. Some argued that the proposed change so violated the spirit of the Constitution that it would not be a valid amendment, but would instead constitute revolution. Some opponents warned that the amendment would lead to full citizenship for blacks. President Lincoln became more aggressive. At Lincoln's request, Republicans included a call for an abolition amendment into their 1864 national platform. In his inaugural address in 1864, the president encouraged Congress to consider the amendment once again. This time, upon its second introduction, Lincoln used the full powers of his office to secure the amendment's passage. With both conservative Republicans and opposition Democrats, Lincoln argued the necessity for this amendment. We heard earlier from Senator Cornyn about Union General Granger's declaration for enforcement to end slavery on June 19, 1865. Today, Juneteenth, celebrated on June 19th, is the name given to Emancipation Day by African Americans in Texas. Treated by many citizens like a 4th of July, large Juneteenth celebrations began in 1866 and continue today.
On January 31st, 1865, the amendment passed the House of Representatives by a vote of 119-56 and was submitted to the states for ratification by at least three-fourths of the states. The operative part of the amendment consisted of one sentence, and I quote, "Neither slavery nor involuntary servitude, except as a punishment for a crime whereof the party shall have been duly convicted, shall exist within the United States or any place subject to their jurisdiction." After final passage of the amendment, an Ohio newspaper reported the following, and I quote, "When the calling of the roll was completed, the clerk proceeded to read the names. The result of the vote was noted on a piece of paper and handed to the speaker, who announced the passage of the joint resolution by a vote of 119 yeas against 56 nays. Thereupon rose a shout applause. The members on the floor huzzed in chorus with the galleries. The ladies in the House assemblage waved their handkerchiefs, and again the applause was repeated. The audience was wildly excited, and the friends of the measure were jubilant. Roughly 10 months later, the state of South Carolina ratified the 13th Amendment on November 13th, 1865.
In review, by February of 1865, the states of Illinois, Rhode Island, Michigan, Maryland, New York, Pennsylvania, West Virginia, Missouri, Maine, Kansas, Massachusetts, Virginia, Ohio, Indiana, Nevada, Louisiana, Minnesota, and Wisconsin had ratified the 13th Amendment. Vermont ratified in March, Tennessee and Arkansas in April, followed by Connecticut in May, New Hampshire in July, South Carolina in November. Alabama and North Carolina ratify at the start of December. Then finally, on December 6th, 1865, my home state of Georgia became the 27th state to ratify the 13th Amendment, and thus provided the requisite number of states for ratification. The 13th Amendment became effective the moment that the Georgia legislature ratified it. 245 years of slavery in the United States of America is legally abolished. Hallelujah. Nearly 4 million slaves are free. To God be the glory.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Louise Toppin.
Sing a song, full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of a new day begun, let us march on till victory is won. Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod, felt in the days when hope unborn had died, yet with a steady which our fathers sighed. We have come over a way that with tears has been watered. We have come treading the path through the blood of the slaughtered. Out from the gloomy stand at last where the bright rim of our bright star is cast. God of all weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who hast brought places our God where we met thee. Lest our hearts, drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Shadowed beneath thy hand, may we
ladies and gentlemen, the Democratic leader of the United States House of Representatives, the Honorable Nancy Pelosi.
Good morning. Today we gather to observe that 150 years ago, our nation took a giant step toward honoring the ideals at the heart of our democracy. At long last, we stopped poisoning the soul of our country with the atrocity of slavery. At long last, we broke the shackles that debased the American dream of justice and equality. We have marked many milestone anniversaries in this year: 150 years of the 13th Amendment, 50 years since the Selma March, and the passage of the Voting Rights Act. With each commemoration, we reflect on the wrongs that denied the humanity of so many millions in our country. With each, we celebrate the triumph of dignity, determination, and courage that are the pride of America. With each, we rededicate ourselves to the march toward justice that is the heritage and the hope of our democracy. In this commemoration, we are surrounded by memories of that continuing march. I am very proud of the progress that our initiatives to have more statues of women and people of color gracing the halls of Congress, heroes of our country, such as Rosa Parks, Helen Keller, Sojourner Truth, right here in Emancipation Hall. I'm reminded that on April 28, 2009, we unveiled the bust of Sojourner Truth here in Emancipation Hall. Then we were honored with the presence of the new First Lady, Michelle Obama. She said that day, and I carry this in my heart, she said, "I hope that Sojourner Truth would be proud to see me, a descendant of slaves, serving as the First Lady of the United States of America." Mm-hmm. 150 years after the ratification of the 13th Amendment, 50 years after the Voting Rights Act, Sojourner Truth would be proud of our Congressional Black Caucus, the conscience of the Congress. She would also be very proud, as we all are, that this observance today is graced with the presence of the President of the United States, Barack Obama. God has truly blessed America. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Majority Leader of the United States House of Representatives, the Honorable Kevin McCarthy.
The words of our founders are unmistakable. All people are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. That among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Yet for years, for decades, African Americans were forced to live in this country as if those words did not apply to everyone. The ratification of the 13th Amendment was the most significant act in our history since our founding. It stands as a marker where America decided it would strive to live out the universal ideals of our nation instead of accepting the wrongs of our past. Our country stood up and demanded that slavery should exist no more. Hundreds of thousands died to allow this amendment to pass. And in the years and generations that followed, more fought to ensure that African Americans would be treated with the same respect and guaranteed the same rights as everyone in this country. Today, we will join together remembering this great moment of freedom. May we all emulate the courage of those in the past and continue to fight for the dignity and rights to make this a more perfect union.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Democratic Leader of the United States Senate, the Honorable Harry Reid.
Frederick Douglass said, quote, "You're not judged by the height you've risen, but from the depth you've climbed," close quote. 150 years ago, our nation resolved to climb out of the deepest, darkest chapter in American history, the insidious institution of slavery. The ratification of the 13th Amendment marked a turning point in our nation's history, a turning point reached through the anguish of civil war, preceded by the tireless efforts of men and women determined to rid our nation from the scourge of slavery. Slavery was a heartless institution where humans were treated as property, sold and traded for commercial gain, without concern for family. Imagine your husband, your wife, your daughter, your son being sold down the river. You often hear that expression today, but that's where it came from, sold down the river. How often do they stop to think about what it really means? We should. From the depths of slavery rose a host of courageous men and women who are determined to fight for their freedom. For me, there is no greater representation of the determination, the courage exemplified by those enslaved than a tiny little woman, 5 foot tall, by the name of Harriet Tubman. Born a slave, Harriet Tubman resolved to escape to the North in pursuit of freedom. But she always carried the haunting scars of slavery. She was struck in the head by a 12-pound iron as a slave. It was thrown at one of the other slaves, but it hit her in the head. She suffered the rest of her life, debilitating headaches, and on occasion, seizures. But when she finally escaped in 1849, she returned to the South to rescue her family and soon began returning with others. Over 10 years, this woman made 19 trips into the South from the North and escorted over 300 slaves to freedom. She was a tough woman. Tubman was leading a group of slaves to freedom. They'd run into some problems or people around that they didn't want to see them. They had to hide in a thicket, thick vegetation, for several days. The two slaves she was bringing to freedom had had enough and said, "We're going back." Harriet Tubman, you see, carried a pistol every place she went. And when the two slaves threatened to leave, risking her freedom and others in the past, she aimed the pistol at the two men and said, you go on, or you die." They decided to stay. That's who she was. She was patient, courageous, brave, and very, very tough. We must embody the strength and tenacity for which Harriet Tubman pursued freedom. We can never give up because the work of perfecting our union requires persistence. Every day we must work together to raise our nation from the depths of the darkest chapters to the higher expression of our values. Throughout our history, the truest American values of freedom, justice, and equality, exemplified by Harriet Tubman, have prevailed. And today, those values are a guiding light in fights for higher wages, better education, criminal justice reform, and many other causes. If we're to continue rising from the depths of our history, we must believe what Harriet Tubman believed. And here's what she said, and I quote, "Within us, each of us, lies the strength, patience, and passion to reach for the stars and change the world," close quote. And as long as we continue to work the work of perfecting our union, we must embrace the words of President Barack Obama, who said and reminded us, quote, "We are the change that we seek," close quote. The progress our nation has made over the last 150 years should serve as a reminder that here in America, freedom, justice, and equality will always win. With that truth in mind, we must reach new heights and pledge today that our nation will live out the true meaning of its creed, liberty and justice for all.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Majority Leader of the United States Senate, the Honorable Mitch McConnell.
It was a January afternoon. The air was frozen in apprehension. It was leavened with anticipation. Hope and fear danced together that day, intermingling as they sometimes do at such important moments in our history, but only briefly. From a presiding officer came the news. Ayes, 119, nays, 56. Minds processed the calculation silently. In one instant, nervous calm. In the next, uproarious cheer. It was the two-thirds that was needed. The House of Representatives had just passed the 13th Amendment to the United States Constitution, as the Senate had done the previous year. Here's how the moment was described when House Speaker Colfax announced the results. A moment of silence succeeded, and then from the floor and the galleries burst a simultaneous shout of joy and triumph, spontaneous, irrepressible, and uncontrollable, swelling and prolonged in one vast volume of reverberating thunder. On the floor, members wept and hugged. In the galleries, the thunder that was described joyous and hopeful rumbled on. Some onlookers who, because of the color of their skin, had been denied access to that very gallery until just the year before, were now celebrating congressional passage of the 13th Amendment. From there, history. President Lincoln would soon add his signature, even though the president plays no formal role in the ratification process. Within just a few short months, the amendment would be ratified. Years of slavery would be legally abolished, millions of slaves would win their freedom, and our country would set off on a new path. Wounded, but hopeful. Scarred, but capable. Always striving, always believing, looking to the future.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Speaker of the United States House of Representatives, the Honorable Paul Ryan.
The 13th Amendment, it's just 43 words long. It is so short that when you read it, you can almost miss its whole significance. You have to stop and remind yourself. 600,000 people died in the Civil War. 600,000 died over 43 words. Or to be more precise, they died in a war that decided whether those 43 words would ever be written. And not everyone supported the 13th Amendment. There was fierce opposition. But I think it's telling that when the state of Maryland held a referendum to abolish slavery, it was the votes of Union soldiers that put it over the top. It was the men who had been in the field and heard the battle cries and seen the heroic deeds. They knew better than most that everyone in the field was an American. A private in the 89th Illinois put it best. He wrote, quote, "I have often heard of men say that they would not fight beside a Negro soldier, but the whites and blacks charged together, and they fell just as well as we did. I have seen great many fighting for our country. Then why should they not be free?" Close quote. It took a war to answer that question. We should be honest with ourselves. It took centuries of cruelty and injustice. But today, we celebrate the moment when our country decided, yes, they should be free. They would be free. And we thought this decision was so important that for the first time in half a century, we amended the Constitution. From then on, it would be the supreme law of the land. And so today, we celebrate this 43-word amendment, this new birth of freedom. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. And we should remember all that it took. The historic battles, the great generals, yes, but also the men in the ranks, the names we have forgotten, especially the men who had once been enslaved, men like William H. Kearney and Andrew Jackson Smith. These men were segregated. They were mistreated, and yet they still fought They fought for a country that had denied them their freedom. They fought for all of us. And so, when we read those 43 short and simple words, we should remember these men and what they did. We should realize those words, like their acts, were gallant, they were noble, profound. We have witnessed true greatness in this country. And when we ratified the 13th Amendment, we could have admitted ourselves to building a country just as great. That is what those 43 words means. This is what they represent. And that is more than worthy of celebration.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States of America.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Please have a seat. Thank you. In giving freedom to the slave, we assure freedom to the free. That's what President Lincoln once wrote. Honorable alike in what we give and what we preserve. We shall nobly save or meanly lose the last best hope of earth. Mr. Speaker, leaders and members of both parties, distinguished guests, we gather here to commemorate a century and a half of freedom, not simply for former slaves, but for all of us. Today, the issue of chattel slavery seems so simple, so obvious. It is wrong in every sense. Stealing men, women, and children from their homelands, tearing husbands from wife, parent from child, stripped and sold to the highest bidder, shackled in chains and bloodied with the whip. It's antithetical not only to our conception of human rights and dignity, but to our conception of ourselves, a people founded on the premise that all are created equal. And to many at the time, that judgment was clear as well. Preachers, black and white, railed against this moral outrage from the pulpit. Former slaves rattled the conscience of Americans in books and pamphlets and speeches. Men and women organized anti-slavery conventions and fundraising drives. Farmers and shopkeepers opened their barns, their homes, their cellars as way stations on an underground railroad, where African Americans often risked their own freedom to ensure the freedom of others. And enslaved Americans, with no rights of their own, they ran north and kept the flame of freedom burning, passing it from one generation to the next with their faith and their dignity and their song. The reformers' passion only drove the protectors of the status quo to dig in harder. And for decades, America wrestled with the issue of slavery in a way that we have with no other, before or since. It shaped our politics, and it nearly tore us asunder. Tensions ran so high, so personal, that at one point a lawmaker was beaten unconscious on the Senate floor. Eventually, war broke out. Brother against brother, North against South. At its heart, the question of slavery was never simply about civil rights. It was about the meaning of America, the kind of country we wanted to be, whether this nation might fulfill the call of its birth. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among those are life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness. President Lincoln understood that if we were ever to fully realize that founding promise, it meant not just signing an Emancipation Proclamation, not just winning a war. It meant making the most powerful collective statement we can in our democracy, etching our values into our Constitution. He called it a king's cure for all the evils. 150 years proved the cure to be necessary but not sufficient. Progress proved halting, too often deferred. Newly freed slaves may have been liberated by the letter of the law, but their daily lives told another tale. They couldn't vote. They couldn't fill most occupations. They couldn't protect themselves or their families from indignity or from violence. And so abolitionists and freedmen and women and radical Republicans kept cajoling and kept rabble-rousing, and within a few years of the war's end at Appomattox, we passed two more amendments guaranteeing voting rights, birthright citizenship, equal protection under the law, and still it wasn't enough. For another century, we saw segregation and Jim Crow make a mockery of these amendments, and we saw justice turn a blind eye to mobs with nooses slung over trees. We saw bullets and bombs terrorize generations. And yet, through all this, the call to freedom survived. We hold these truths to be self-evident. And eventually a new generation rose up to march and to organize and to stand up and to sit in with the moral force of nonviolence and the sweet sound of those same freedom songs that slaves had sung so long ago, crying out not for special treatment but for equal rights, calling out for basic justice promised to them almost a century before. Like their abolitionist predecessors, they were plain, humble, ordinary people, armed with little but faith. Faith in the Almighty, faith in each other, and faith in America. Hope, in the face so often of all evidence to the contrary that something better lay around the bend. Because of them, maids and porters and students and farmers and priests and housewives, because of them, a civil rights law was passed and a voting rights law was signed, and doors of opportunity swung open, not just for the black porter, but also for the white chambermaid and the immigrant dishwasher, so that their daughters and their sons might finally imagine a life for themselves beyond washing somebody else's laundry or shining somebody else's shoes. Freedom for you and for me. Freedom for all of us. And that's what we celebrate today. The long arc of progress. Progress that is never assured, never guaranteed, but always possible. Always there to be earned. No matter how stuck we might seem sometimes, no matter how divided or despairing we may appear, no matter what ugliness may bubble up, progress, so long as we're willing to push for it, so long as we're willing to reach for each other. We would do a disservice to those warriors of justice, Tubman and Douglas, and Lincoln and King, were we to deny that the scars of our nation's original sin are still with us today. We condemn ourselves to shackles once more if we fail to answer those who wonder if they're truly equals in their communities, or in their justice systems, or in a job interview. We betray the efforts of the past if we fail to push back against bigotry in all its forms. But we betray our most noble past as well if we were to deny the possibility of movement, the possibility of progress. If we were to let cynicism consume us and fear overwhelm us. If we lost hope, for however slow, however incomplete, however harshly, loudly, rudely challenged at each point along our journey in America, we can create the change that we seek. All it requires is that our generation be willing to do what those who came before us have done, to rise above the cynicism and rise above the fear, to hold fast to our values, to see ourselves in each other, to cherish dignity and opportunity, not just for our own children, but for somebody else's child. To remember that our freedom is bound up with the freedom of others, regardless of what they look like, or where they come from, or what their last name is, or what faith they practice. To be honorable. To be honorable alike in what we give and what we preserve. To nobly save or meanly lose the last best hope of earth. To nobly save or meanly lose the last best hope of earth. That is our choice. Today, we affirm hope. Thank you. God bless you. May God bless the United States of America.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stand as the chaplain of the United States Senate, Dr. Barry Black, gives the benediction.
Let us pray. God of our weary years and silent tears, the only source of true freedom, we thank you for this opportunity to commemorate the ratification of the 13th Amendment, which abolished the peculiar institution of slavery and helped to give America a new birth of freedom. May our commemoration of this transformational amendment make us more vigilant in this time of polarization to protect the freedoms of all human beings, regardless of race, gender, color, creed, language, or religion. May commemorating this constitutional achievement reaffirm that every human being is an heir to a legacy of dignity and freedom. Lord, in this generation, keep our feet on the right path as you use us to ensure that justice will roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. We pray this prayer in the name of Him who came to set us free. Amen.
Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain in your seats for the departure of the official party.